This morning I want to talk about a great 11th century mystical writer, St. Symeon, the new theologian. Indeed, I've got so many things to say about him that I shall probably need two talks instead of one to say it all. In this, the first of my two talks, I shall speak about Symeon's view of the Holy Spirit. So we could give his title, St. Symeon the New Theologian, Personal Experience of the Holy Spirit. St. Symeon is a theologian poet, and often it's the poets who are the best theologians of all. I think of St. Ephrem the Syrian in the 4th century, or of Dante, Milton, William Blake, who is a great favorite of mine, and then in the 20th century writers such as T.S. Eliot, Edwin Muir, Kathleen Ray. Yes, often it is indeed the poets who are the best theologians, and perhaps we do not listen to them quite as much as we should. Here is a typical passage from St. Symeon, from his Hymns of Divine Love. And he speaks about what is a major theme in his mystical theology, the divine light. O light in three persons, Father, Son, and Spirit. O light that none can name, for it is altogether nameless. O light with many names, for it is at work in all things. O power of the divine fire, O strange energy, you who dissolve the rocks and hills by your fear alone, you who dwell in light, wholly unapproachable, how in your essence, totally divine, do you mingle yourself with grass? How, while continuing unchanged, altogether inaccessible, do you preserve the nature of the grass, unconsumed? How, while keeping our nature unaltered, do you yet transform it entirely? Remaining grass, it is light, and yet the light is not grass. But you, the light, are joined with the grass in a union without confusion, and the grass becomes light. It is transfigured, yet unchanged. There, Symeon is expressing a point of view that I've already emphasized in these talks. He is speaking of the simultaneous otherness yet nearness of the divine. God is transcendent, beyond our understanding. He is the light that none can name, for it is altogether nameless. Yet God is immanent, everywhere present, filling all things. He is with many names, for he is at work in all things. God, says Symeon in the passage I've just read, dwells in light wholly unapproachable. Yet he is mingled with us created beings, in a union without confusion. He speaks of God as fire, he speaks of us as grass. And we, the grass, are united with the fire, and yet we are not consumed. We become what he is, yet we remain our own true selves. Here then, Symeon is setting before us the basic mystical paradox. Who then was Symeon? We know, in fact, a great deal about him, because he speaks very often in his writings concerning his own experience. Sometimes he speaks of himself in the third person, but often he speaks directly, saying, I. And he writes then about his inner spiritual life in an explicit way. This is unusual in the Christian East. It is very hard to find in Eastern Christian spiritual literature a work corresponding to the Confessions of St. Augustine. Someone of whom I shall be speaking later, St. Gregory Palamas in the 14th century, has left thousands of pages of his writings and frequently refers to the vision of divine light. But he only talks about the saints. He says the saints experience this. He never says, I have experienced it, though we may believe that he had. And that is typical of the Eastern Christian approach, self-effacing. Mystical theology is indeed based on personal experience, but though the Eastern Christian writers speak from their personal experience, they do not necessarily speak directly about it. Symeon is an exception. He often speaks of what God has shown to him. Not in order that we should admire him. Rather, his argument is, if I, weak that I am, sinful that I am, have experienced all these things, then you could do so too. His point is not to set himself above us, but to encourage us. I might say a word about his name, the new theologian. Here, theology is being used not primarily in the sense of an academic discipline taught in universities and seminaries, but rather theology means the vision of God, as in the words of Evagrius that I quoted in an earlier talk. The theologian is the one who prays truly, and if you pray truly, you are a theologian. So that is the sense in which we call Symeon a theologian, one who was granted the vision of God. And there are, in fact, in the Christian East, three figures who are especially termed the theologian. First, St. John, the apostle and evangelist, author of the most mystical of the four Gospels, John the theologian. Then, in the 4th century, St. Gregory of Nazianzus, the close friend of St. Basil, author of a great deal of mystical poetry. And he too is known as Gregory the theologian. So if Symeon in the 11th century is called the new theologian. This means that he revives and forms a new witness to this tradition of mystical theology, of which St. John the Evangelist and St. Gregory of Nazianzus are already spokesmen. So, who was Symeon? He was born in 949 in Asia Minor from the provincial nobility. And as an adolescent, about 14, he was sent to by his family to the imperial capital. And they envisaged that he would follow a career as a courtier in the imperial service.